The story of God's zeal, of how he planned and prepared before calling God's people, the story of the love of God who prepared the environment, and Moses, a man to lead the people before calling God's people, will continue.
The eternal and unchanging word of God.
One story 15. Prosperity and oppression. Lamentation and Moses. Reasons for entering Egypt. Picture of salvation. God had his plan and purpose, and therefore God sent his people to Egypt. In order to make God's people, there had to be a king, people, and a zone where the king and the people can live without shame. The land is represented by Canaan, but the realm is not a visible land. God, the king of the kingdom of God, is perfect from eternity to eternity. When there was no shame in our relationship with God, Eden was the kingdom of God. But after the sin of Adam and Eve, Eden was no longer the kingdom of God. And Adam and Eve and their descendants, who were driven out of Eden, constantly sinned, so they could not find or achieve the kingdom of God. It was because they did not obey the laws God gave to his people to keep. So God redraws the picture of God's salvation, starting with Abraham. God's salvation first comes from this world, a calling from the land of abundance but sin-filled city of sin. Then he gets rid of our heart that lingers on this earth and makes us break away from that heart completely. Finally, he makes us recognize and acknowledge that this world is not a true place for God's people to live in, and leads us to his kingdom, our hometown. So on this earth, even if we are not luxurious, we will have a more blessed death than those who have everything in this world. And the first step to this is the calling and bringing us out of the rich land that symbolizes this earth. That is why God called Abraham from the Ur, which was in the rich region of Mesopotamia, and brought him to Canaan, a land of famine. While we believe in Jesus Christ, things can go well on this earth for a while, like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. But that is not the purpose of calling. We may have the silver and gold, and sheep and cattle, male and female donkeys, male and female servants, and camels, which Abraham obtained when he went down to Egypt without communication with God. But these were not given to be enjoyed, but to be let go one by one while getting to know more and more about God. When God told Isaac not to go down to Egypt and he obeyed, he reaped 100 times what he sowed and received God's blessing. Not because God would keep making him prosperous like that, but to show him a taste of the richness of the kingdom of God. The large flocks and female and male servants and camel and donkeys that was given to Jacob was not for him to live well without God, but to recognize and return to God, who protected him even in times of trouble. Like Joseph, we can have worldly powers, but that was not the ultimate blessing of salvation given to Joseph. We must know that it was a short-lived power God gave him for the kingdom of God. Therefore, we must remember the words about the Exodus, which God constantly talked about, starting with Abraham. God's sending of God's people to Egypt was not to give them Egypt's abundance, but is making a statement about how God's journey of salvation will begin with the departure from the world's riches like Egypt. Egypt was a land of abundance because of the Nile River, which allowed them to get water easily. Egypt was like the garden of the Lord, and as abundant as it was also rich in idols and full of sins. In their abundance, human beings who are sinners have failed to recognize God, who is in charge of natural things and life and death, and changed the glory of God into idols. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools, and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being, and birds, and animals, and reptiles. Prosperity. The Bible says that the number of God's people in Egypt multiplied greatly, increased in numbers, and became so numerous that the land was filled with them. It is even said that the more oppressed they were, the more prosperous they became. God let the people multiply greatly, increase in number, and become so numerous that the land was filled with them to make God's people into one nation, one country. But the sinners who wanted to enjoy the richness in the world did not know the cause of their prosperity. Repeated will of Exodus from the beginning of Abraham through Jacob and through Joseph should have been the wish of their minds, passed from parent to child. But the riches of Egypt were, of course, enough to win their hearts. The legacy of faith that should have been passed down from generation to generation was buried in the riches of Egypt. King who does not know Joseph. 400 years have passed since it was God's time for Jacob's company to go down to Egypt. It was now the time that God spoke to Abraham about. But God's people did not want the Exodus. Perhaps the will of the Exodus became a legend. At this time, a king who does not know Joseph appears, and the king does not know the merit of Joseph who saved Egypt and the other countries from the famine. And because of him, they had masters who looked over them, oppressed them, forced them to labor, and bullied them. And they were forced to build Phutom and Ramesses as store cities for Pharaoh. For the people who enjoyed the abundances they had, this was suffering. But we know it means that the richness of the world is not a blessing, but knowing God is a blessing. And the poverty of the world is not a curse, but not knowing God is a curse. Therefore, as God did to Jacob, God will start cornering God's people, the Israelites. Oppression. Because of a king who did not know Joseph, suffering and labor began, and the Bible says that they were oppressed. The king of Egypt even ordered to kill all of the boys born to the Hebrew midwives, and told the people to throw the boys that were born into the Nile. God's care. God took care of the growth and prosperity of his people. The more oppressed they were by the Egyptian king, the more they prospered. According to the king's command, when a boy was born, all of them had to be killed. But God took care of the midwives who feared God and violated the king's order. If the blessing is not from God, it will bring suffering and there will be no way to escape. But if adversity is from God, it will bring blessing and there surely is a way to avoid it. Lamentation. Until now, even though they lived in foreign countries like slaves, God's people were buried in the abundance of Egypt and had no lamentations. But now they begin to lament. Even after the Egyptian king dies, the oppression did not stop. And they lamented and cried because of the hard labor. And this was heard by God, and God took care of them. God never let his people suffer, but he allowed a moment of oppression by the Egyptian king for God and his kingdom, ultimately causing God's people to lament about their life in Egypt. And that is the time God has already spoken about, and is the time God has prepared. God didn't look for a way because of the situation, but just as God had already prepared and created a perfect heaven, he had already planned the journey of Exodus, sent the people to Egypt, and God's people began to cry out when it was time for the Exodus. Moses before his calling. Like his forefathers of faith, Moses also goes through the journey of faith and is used as a man of God. Moses too had an unstable faith and some weaknesses, but the Bible says since then no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. However, without the grace and support of God, he is just a sinner. Reed basket. Moses was born as a Levite. Moses already had his older brother Aaron and Miriam, and there was a 3-year gap between Aaron and Moses, but a larger gap between him and Miriam. When Moses was born, his mother Jochebed saw that he was different from other children, other babies. So even though the Egyptian king ordered all male children to be killed and thrown in the Nile River, she hid the baby for 3 months. And when she could not hide him anymore, she painted the reed basket with bitumen and wood gin, placed the baby in the basket, and left him between the reeds of the Nile River, and made Miriam watch over him. At this time, the reed basket containing Moses is like the ark, which saved the lives of God's people during the judgment of water. and the ark in the tabernacle of God in the wilderness of Exodus. The reed basket was painted with bitumen like the ark, and the ark wrapped in gold was sprinkled with the blood of the sin offering. Moses' life will be saved through this reed basket, like the ark that saved God's people at the time of the water judgment. And in the future, he will become a leader of God's people and save them through the ark of the tabernacle. Moses. The Pharaoh commanded that all the sons be killed when they were born. But by God's will, the Pharaoh's daughter came to the Nile River for a bath and found Moses, who was there. She feels pity, and Moses' sister, who appeared at that time, introduces Moses' mother, and Moses grows up safely in the hand of his mother. When he grew up, he was sent to the king's daughter, and as a prince of Egypt, he learned all the wisdom of the Egyptians and becomes fluent in speaking and good at what he does. It is the king's daughter who named the child Moses, meaning taken out of the water. And with the reed box, the meaning of Moses' name also implies that in the future, Moses will deliver God's people from Egypt, the sea of sin, and from the Red Sea, the water of death. Moses who receives his calling. We don't know when Moses received God's call of salvation. When he received his calling at the age of 80, it is better to see it as a call for mission rather than a call for salvation. When Moses grew up in the hands of his birth mother, he would have the identity for his people, and he must have heard of the God of their ancestors. Moses living the child of God, the life of a sinner. 40 years passes and Moses turns 40 years old. There must have been a conflict in Moses' life for 40 years as a prince in Egypt. From a young age, Moses grew up as a prince in Egypt's royal palace. But he heard and knew that he was a Hebrew. And so, when Moses sees an Egyptian torment his brothers, the Hebrews, he kills the Egyptian. The next day, he sees the two Hebrews fighting and tries to intervene. But they begin to oppose Moses, and Moses flees to the land of Midian to escape the Pharaoh. If Moses had no faith in God, he would have been able to live for the rest of his life in abundance. But he certainly had faith, even if he was in the process of up and down. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God, rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of great value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. It is not yet God's time, nor way. As a prince of Egypt for 40 years, Moses would have the ability, strength, power, and skills, and would have thought he was prepared. Moses thought his own people would realize that God was using him to rescue them. But it is not yet God's time for the Exodus, nor was this God's way to save the Israelites. Moses thought he was ready for God to use him to save the Israelites. However, God's way of saving God's people through Moses was a bigger picture, not just bringing one or two people out, but bringing the entire Israelite people from the Egypt. That was like Babylon. Another 40 years. Eventually, Moses goes to the Midian wilderness and prepares for another 40 years. If the preceding 40 years were a period of preparation for a talent with power and abilities, now the 40 years is a period of self-denial and to find the dying virtue. If Moses had been used as a man of God during his early 40s, the Israelites may have been killed by Moses before being killed by God in the wilderness. In the land of Midian, Moses meets Jethro, a priest God had prepared for him, and his daughter Zipporah marries her, gave birth to a son, and names him Gershom, which means I am a foreigner in another country. This foreigner, together with the reed box and Moses' name, are clues of Moses' mission. Moses does not know the future, so he will not know that this wilderness where he will struggle for 40 years is the path he has to take with God's people in the future. Like this, God prepared a man of God for the exodus of God's people. The Israelites lamented and cried because of the hard labor, but God planned everything thoroughly before creation, and this is still going on. Moses lives as a foreigner, receives his mission. Moses receives his calling. He received his calling like Joseph did. Moses herded his father-in-law's sheep, and one day he reached Mount Horeb. There he met God, where God was waiting for Moses. Moses saw a bush that was on fire but was not burning up, approached it, and God called Moses from the flames. Like God said to Jacob, he now puts Jacob's name and says, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. This meant that like God was the God of their ancestors, God will be the God of Moses and of the Israelites. God says that he clearly sees the suffering of God's people in Egypt and hears their cries and knows their anxieties. So God says that he will go down and save them from the hands of the Egyptians and lead them to a land of where milk and honey flowed. And he tells Moses, go. God sends Moses, and God says that he would lead the people of Israel, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. The subject is God. God will do it. But in all this work, Moses, who does not know what God has done and will do, doesn't obey right away. Moses, who did not know what he was prepared, began with the question, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And also says, they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? What if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord did not appear to you? Pardon your servant, Lord, I am slow of speech and tongue. And even pardon your servant, Lord, please send someone else. However, it is better to see Moses not obeying as the dying of Moses rather than disobedience. If he was the Moses at the age of 40, of course he would have obeyed with amen. But the Moses right now is dead. There is no body, no confidence, and no human motivation. That is why God is calling Moses at this time. Moses at the age of 80 cannot do it. That is why Moses is saying, I can't do it. However, being proud and declaring I can do it and being weak and saying I can't do it is different. God will now use I can't do it Moses to be the leader of the Exodus. God will kill the aged 40 I can do it Moses in the wilderness and now reveal himself through the aged I can do it Moses. He will lead them back to God's zeal. This is because it is a covenant given to Abraham, God's way, and God's dream, God's vision that was given to Joseph. The Israelites had to know what God had done before being called by God through Moses. They had to believe, pass the wilderness, and go to the Canaan which God spoken about from the time of Abraham. However, because Egypt was greater than God for the Israelites, they had to spend and endure the same 40 years that was spent killing Moses, that too in the wilderness. The story of God's zeal, of how he planned and prepared before calling God's people, the story of the love of God who prepared the environment, and Moses, a man to lead the people before calling God's people, will continue.